Hi, I'm Darren Decker and this is Herb Brooks, and we're going to demonstrate how to install a capillary GC column. This demonstration is suitable for the majority of capillary columns that Agilent manufactures. There may be more specific conditioning, care, and maintenance procedures for your new GC column. Be certain to read all the information that comes with your column. There are a few tools you'll need to change your column. You'll want a column cutting tool. A ceramic wafer, which is shown here, is pretty much the standard these days. We used to use a sapphire rod or a diamond tip scribe back in the day, but ever since the ceramic wafer has been around, it pretty much retired the other cutters because it's so easy to use. A magnifying glass is good to have on hand to inspect your column cuts. You also might want to have a supply of an appropriate non-retained compound such as methane or butane if you're using an FID. For a mass spec, you can use argon or air. It's a good idea to have an electronic flow meter and an electric leak detector on hand too. Finally, you might want to have a test mix ready to run when you're done installing your column, but this is not necessary because every Agilent column is pre-tested before it is sent to you, so you have a high level of confidence that it will work as expected right out of the box. I'd like to have one of my standards around to inject to verify that everything's installed correctly and the settings are right. Nothing tells me my system's ready like my standard. Of course, you'll want to wear safety glasses. And a lot of people like to use gloves when handling columns. There actually is a bit of debate over whether or not to use gloves. I guess as far as I'm concerned, I just want to make sure that you don't get anything on the part of the column that will be in the flow path and then show up in your system. Any contamination, especially oily things, can be pretty persistent if it gets in the flow path. You don't want to chromatograph your lunch. Here's what a French fry looks like. Check out the experiment. They held a French fry for 5 seconds, then wiped their finger to remove as much of the offending material as possible, then lightly touched the part of the column above the ferrule, installed it, and voila, French fry. Now, this will go away over time, but better off to start without it. Does that mean we need gloves? No, it just means make sure your hands are clean before installing a column. But even that can be troublesome. Here's what liquid soap looks like with the same experiment. Remember, a little goes a long way. Now, in my opinion, gloves are not necessary. And if you have problems like this, just make sure you take a lab wipe, put some acetone or methanol on it, and just wipe off the ends of the column before you install them. If you never see this, don't worry about it. Now, before we get started, it's a good time to check gas traps for expiration and replace if necessary. We're on the new system, our traps are fine. Since the system is down for a column change, it's a good time to change any inlet consumables as well. Install a new septa in the inlet, look at your liner. If it's visibly dirty, you should replace it. Sometimes, even though it looks clean, the liner needs to be replaced because it becomes active. This is usually seen on the chromatographic results as a loss in response or tailing of active compounds. If for any reason the liner needs to be replaced, make sure to use new O-rings. O-rings break down and lose their elasticity over time. And you usually don't get as good of a seal if you try to reuse it. If the liner is dirty or damaged, chances are the stationary phase on the first portion of the column is as well. Also, the liquid phase in the column can be easily damaged by oxygen at temperatures above ambient, so making sure everything is leak-free after we're done is critical. Agilent also recommends using traps on the carrier gas lines as an extra measure of protection against contaminants. And therefore, it'll extend your column lifetime and minimize background noise. Our gas management video covers more information about that. We do need to be careful when cutting columns as they are made of glass, so safety glasses are a must. So let's get started. First, we place the column on the GC oven column hanger, making sure that the column tubing does not touch any of the sides of the oven. Now we need to unwind enough column to obtain a smoothly curved section of tubing connected to the inlet. Avoid tight bends as this stresses the tubing and could cause breakage. Make sure that the column tag, sharp edges, or other items don't rub against the column. Next, we place the column nut and ferrule over one end of the column. Now, we like to put a septa on there first because we're going to use that to help us in the measurement later. Now there is no front or back to the column, however most people I know install the column with the post of the column cage pointing towards the oven door. We cut the end of the column after nut and ferrule placement so that we don't leave any ferrule material in the end of the column. Hold a section of the column like this. If you run your finger on the edges of the ceramic wafer, you'll notice there's a rough and a smooth edge. You want to use the smooth edge towards the column. In one motion, run the edge of the ceramic wafer at a slight angle across the edge of the column. Do not press hard enough to cut completely through the tubing, but hard enough to cut the outside polyimide coating and score the underlying glass. Grasp the column on each side of the scribe mark, bend it away from the mark, or sometimes I just like to hit the top of it with the wafer, and then pull it away after it breaks. Inspect the column end with a magnifier. Ensure the cut is at a right angle to the tubing wall, free of any chips, burrs, excess polyimide hanging out, or any uneven areas. And do it again if necessary. Now, the optimal insertion distance for most installations of the column into the splitless inlet is going to be 4 to 6 millimeters from the top of the ferrule to the tip of the column. But this might change for certain liners. Call technical support if you have any questions on the proper length. We want to make sure the tip of the column is just above the gold seal. Now, a little bit high is okay, but too low will be a problem. After setting the distance, this would be a good time to wipe the end of the column with a lab wipe and some acetone or methanol, like we talked about earlier. For other inlets, other than the splitless, consult the GC instruction manual for the proper insertion depth and technique. Now, with the column at its proper position, finger tighten the column nut, using a wrench to tighten an additional half turn. If the column can be moved in the fitting, tighten another quarter turn. Failure to achieve a leak-free seal will cause rapid and permanent column damage when you heat the column. Do not move the column while tightening the nut. Now, people have used liquid paper in the past to mark the column at the proper distance, but as I said earlier, we like using a septa already on the column to hold it in position. So before you even put the nut and ferrule on, make sure you put that old septa on, and it's a nice little trick. Ferrules, especially those made of graphite vespel, will change shape slightly upon heating. If the column was installed while the inlet and detector were cool, retighten the fitting. It's also good practice to check again after conditioning of the column just to make sure that the column nuts are tight. Adjust the head pressure to obtain a reasonable gas flow rate. The setting will vary. For example, for a 30-meter column using helium carrier gas, the head pressure setting is going to be between 15 and 25 psi for a 0.25 millimeter ID column. These values are recommended starting points only. The actual head pressure will depend on the carrier flow rate that you need in your method.